Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
What's going on, guys? This is Zeke. This is Dogumentary TV, YouTube channel for dog lovers. If you guys haven't already, please go ahead and subscribe to the channel. All right, guys, we're going to get started in a second. We'll let the room fill up a little bit. We have about 12 people right now. And folks, get up in there. So yesterday I posted a video about the rustic Presa Canario with Gavin Goins Jr. We're going to talk to him today, and we're going to kind of reiterate some of the things that he said in the video. If you didn't get to see the video, we'll talk about that today. We're going to go through some of the comments left on the video yesterday, and then we're going to actually go take some live questions if you guys want to call in. Not right now, but a little bit later. There's a link in the description of the video. Feel free to call in and ask your questions directly to Mr. Goins. We got some folks up in here. If you guys want to support the channel, you can hit the super chat at any time. It's taking all kind of super chats today. I love super chats. If you want to like the video, I love all kind of likes. If you want to subscribe to the channel, if you're not already subscribed, please go ahead and subscribe to the channel as well. All right, let me bring Mr. Gavin Goins Jr. into the conversation. Okay. Bam, what's going on, brother?
What's going on, my man? How you doing?
I'm wonderful, man. I'm wonderful. Let me just go ahead and give my preamble. So I think I found you through my Facebook page or your Facebook friends. I saw your dog, Kaza, and I was like, he got this dog mislabeled. That ain't no Presa.
Right.
So I was intrigued because I know a lot about, you know, breeds like the Presa, all utility farm dogs, all dogs that were bred with a working purpose. They have, They don't subscribe to the pure breed mentality, right? So we have different things. We have cousins, and you know, it's like in the black community, right? We got light skinned cousins, we got dark skinned cousins.
And I'm from New Orleans. We have
a lot of that. Black, right? You can't say, oh, look, he don't look white. He can't be your Kanashma cousin, man. Blood cousin. That's kind of how it is when people are doing, you know, when people are making a way and doing with dogs. Are having dogs to work and to do a purpose, right? They're not so much concerned about the continuity of the phenotype. They're not so much concerned with the color, the height. They're definitely concerned with the temperament. Always temperament is something that always is consistent. Health is always consistent. You always want a sound dog and a healthy dog, but you don't really care what it looks like. If you got a farm and you need a dog to work, you need them to work.
Right.
So go ahead. You got King Toto's Presas down there in New Orleans. New Orleans, right? Or Louisiana?
Yes, sir.
New Orleans. Okay, perfect. And just tell me about your kennel. And again, just introduce yourself to the Dogumentary TV fans.
Okay, well, I'm Gavin Goins Jr. from New Orleans, Louisiana. I run King Toto Presas here. And you know, we're a breeding program. I don't usually say kennel, I say breeding program. Just because we just strive to be more than just a kennel. You know, our dogs, I feel like when people hear kennel, they just automatically think of dogs lined up in a row, only waiting to get bred. And, you know, so we do so much more than that. Just the socializing, you know, who is that? Kaza, Karma, and Lani. Were all imported from out the country, you know, two from the Canary Islands, one from Germany. The first stop, no matter what, when I get in town, man, it's just a family effort, man. My parents, my sisters, I tell them, bring the kids over. We all meet at my parents' house, and the socializing starts day one, man. Meet my nieces and nephews. My parents have a little dog. You know, my sister has a little miniature poodle that she brings around everywhere. That dog comes, meets everybody. So we just really a family-oriented breeding program, man. You know, I have a bunch of help. You see, my brother-in-law is a photographer, videographer. He helped with the lighting and the background for our video. a lot of the pictures and content on my page. He shoots for me. So, you know, we just like to all pull together and do what's best for the dogs, man. So, you know, that translates to the training, not just protection work, not just, you know, bite sports. It's also heavy on obedience. We also help test, you know, Kaza, I just was talking to you the other day. You know, I was coming from the vet. Kaza had his OFA, hips and elbows done. X-rays look good, just waiting back for the official results, but everything's looking good. Karma's a little older, so she's done, ready to go. So, man, we just, you know, trying to do, you know, everything to where I feel comfortable having my name behind the dog. You know, if a puppy leaves here, it's going to have King Kota Presa on it, you know, the KKP at the end of it. And that's me. So I don't want a puppy to leave here until I feel comfortable on it with it. So I just try to go the extra mile to make sure, not only for my customers, but for me, because, you know, as a breeder, I'm still, and a newer breeder, I'm still looking to bring other blood in. So I can look at it from a customer perspective, buying a puppy, how would I want to be treated? What would I expect from the parents? Things like that. So I feel like I really can help my customers along the way, because I'm still in the same boat. You know, I'm still adding to my program, expanding, adding new blood and things like that. So I really, you know, I'm not out of touch, like just been breeding for so long, whereas I have the best dogs buy a puppy for me, you know. So that's just what I try to do over here.
Right. So now you have presses. You have what I call rustic. I don't know what the term for it. The way I use rustic means... rustic meaning old, before the reclamation, and a lot of rustic breeds. I mean, you got the Borbo, yeah. Cane Corso, Presses, any farm dog. You know, at some point when it was introduced to a kennel club, went through a reclamation, and anything to me before that reclamation, I would consider to be a rustic version of the breed, something that goes back to the old style or old way. So your dogs are rustic presses, based on my definition, and probably a legitimate definition. What does that mean to you? And how does that differ from the FCI version of and UKC versions of the presser?
In my opinion, it differs because we're going, okay, just like some of the pictures that I sent you that you used during the video while we're talking. I mean, just in simplest form, you know, you look at those pictures and you look at my dogs, you know, and I know some people get stuck on the color with the white, but let's say Karma, for instance, the fawn. She looks like fawn dogs that from the older pictures in the 70s, the 80s, things like that. She doesn't look like a lot of the, like, you can pull maybe a FCI champion, you know, dog that's fawn, and you're gonna see differences in her. You're gonna see differences for sure in the temperament and drive, definitely in the structures. They tend to, newer, you know, Dogo Canario show style is gonna have a higher rear. I've been noticing a lot of them are getting shorter, thicker bone, wider, things like that. You know, whereas Karma, you see it, she's ripped, man, she's an athlete. So, you know, thicker base tail, bushier tail, heavier coat. Even like the 1989 standard says the coat should be thicker around the neck and shoulder area. They all have that. So yeah, just a rustic dog. And like I said, to me, it doesn't get any more rustic than going to the birthplace of the breed. So that's what I wanted to do. And I started researching, you know, talking to different breeders out there. Also, a few breeders helped me along the way. John Wilson, a very, very good breed I respect in the UK, you know, actually helped me with getting my first presser from the Canary Islands, because it's kind of like you got to be in the know sometimes, you know? Like, they don't always answer those Facebook Messenger DMs from American breeders or American consumers, you know?
Right. So yep. talk about the fact that let's talk about the working abilities. Obviously, my focus. There we go. I would suggest, or I would say that, you know, I don't think the FCI standard, the FCI presses are bad. I mean, there's a spectrum on all kennel club dogs, right? It's really about the breeding program.
In both, yeah, right. For sure.
But so I've only seen FCI presses or UKC presses, and they work. You know what I'm saying? But do you have an experience with both? How would you qualify the differences in the work ethic or the workability of the rustic versions and the more modern dogs?
Okay, from my observation, first off, I'll start with, you know, I'm not here to bash the other dogs, and you know, I think some people.
All right, we're losing you a little bit.
It's not that, but basically, go ahead.
Say that over. Say that again for me. Say that again for me. You froze up a little bit.
Okay. Just from my experience with the breed, and you know, I've traveled, visit other kennels. I've been to the U.S. Monographica, the biggest Presa Canario dog show. So you know, I've had a good grasp of seeing both styles, and the biggest thing I noticed is that not saying a FCI registered Presa can't work. I'm not saying that at all, but your chances of getting working types in that litter is going to be a few out of that litter. You're not gonna bat 1,000. You know what I'm saying? You're gonna have a more spread of temperament. But I can say with these working lines, with these more rustic lines, I've seen 10 puppies, all 10, you know, working great. Breeder, somebody I consider a mentor, Fear Rios, D7. Great example of that. Had a litter about a year and a half, 2 years ago. All those dogs are a little over a year and a half now. Some of them have been bred. They're producing great dogs. All of the whole litter works. I've seen two of them in person. One of my friends, Billy, owns two of them. Great dogs. Proven on hog. Actually, one of the dogs is the dog I sent a picture to you of with the hog. So, you know, catching, bite work, different things. So I just don't see that consistency in the FCI dogs. And I just feel that is because they're bred more for show and confirmation. You know, when you breed for workability, you know, that's what you're gonna get. So that's why, you know, Kaza can have the white markings, which is, white is not a color, it's a marking. It's just so happened his markings are heavy. That's what it is. You know, the color doesn't change what the breed is. Just because the standard says 20% white doesn't mean as soon as it goes 21%, it changes to another breed. You know, that's not how genetics work. Mm-hmm. So, but what it is, I'll give you an example of when I pick Kaza. You know, I'm picking out of the litter. We're sending videos back and forth. He's sending videos to me. I'm looking for the prey drive. I'm like, okay, all the males had that because I knew I wanted a male. Okay, let's see the grips. They get on the rag. Kaza, full mouth bite. I mean, 5 weeks old, full mouth pushing into the bite. Showing possession, wrapping his paw, front two paws around the rag, around the breeder's ankles, you know, things like that. When it's feeding time, the breeder's coming up. Kaza was the first one running to the front of the kennel, barking, chest out, showing guard instincts. I mean, this is 5-6 weeks old, man. So how can I call myself a working breeder? And I pick the other puppy who he had a brother who's all brindle, because that's the standard.
Right.
I don't see how I'm doing justice to the breed by seeing all these things that he does well that translate to what I want in my program and what I want to do working wise. And then I select another dog because of color. And that's what happens, in my opinion, with the other, with you know, more show dogs. It's show first, it's confirmation first. So if you have a dog showing all these great working signs, but oh, this is out of standard, I'm gonna pick this one. Mm-hmm. But that one has a weaker temperament, more nervy, not as much drive. You're killing the working breed. You know, you're breeding for confirmation. You're not breeding for workability.
Right. So I think you kind of answered the question. I was about to jump into the comments. I know one of the comments that I saw mentioned several times on the video that we posted yesterday, which if you guys haven't seen that video, it's titled "The Presa Canario Dog That You Didn't Know Was a Presa." So get a chance, go check that out. Hold on 1 second. I want to thank James for the super chat. I appreciate that, brother. We'll figure out how to get that on screen real quick. But for the most part, people, again, are talking about the white markings. Explain to everyone how that whole concept came into to being, just based on the fact that it was written into the standard or whatever.
Yeah, so, okay, well, I can tell you a comment I remember that I read. You know, someone said, you know, I guess along the lines of,
You're freezing on me again. Give it a second. All right, guys, we seem to have a hiccup right now. He's frozen, so we're gonna give him a second to come back. Let's see. Gavin, I need you to maybe hang up and call back in. In the meantime, you know, what do you think about Cesar Millan? I like Cesar Millan. I think, you know, the thing about the whole dog thing is, like, you know, there's a spectrum of opinion. There's a spectrum of things that work well for dogs. There's things that don't work well for dogs. I know a lot of people don't agree with Cesar. I know he gets a lot of flack for a lot of things. But I think he's a good trainer. I think he does what he does. I'm sure his show is produced, you know, so obviously he's not as great as he probably looks on television. And there's probably a lot of other work that goes into it. Give me 1 second. I'm going to try to get Gavin back on. All right, cool. So we're going to do that right now. So there's a lot of work that goes into making the show and making Cesar Millan look as wonderful a trainer as he is, as he appears to be on television. But, I mean, I still feel like that what he does and how he does it is pretty good. What I'm going to do is I'm going to see if I can't get – I'm going to find that video file that I posted yesterday, and I'm going to show that to you so you guys can watch that. And I'm going to try to get Gavin back on the line. We had an issue with his video feed, so I'm going to try to get him back on the line. But in the meantime, if you guys haven't seen the video yet already, I'm going to go ahead and play it for you right now.
Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
Hey, Dogumentary TV, this is Gavin Goins Jr. from King Coda Presses in New Orleans, Louisiana. I discovered the Presa Canario through research, mainly online in the beginning. They always had Presa, what they call Presa type dogs on the islands hundreds of years ago. But then when English merchants and settlers came to the islands, they brought over bull terriers and other dogs like that. And they were bred to the original Presa type dogs on the island. And, you know, dog fighting and things like that was popular with the English merchants, and it kind of rubbed off on the natives of the Canary Islands. So they were in the dog fight, and that's where the dog aggression comes from in the breed. Also, though, in the 40s, dog fighting was banned on the islands. And this is kind of where, I guess, a lot of the gray area comes in with the Presa. Because by the dog fighting being banned on the island, it stopped the purpose for making these type of fighting dogs. So the breed kind of went in a almost went extinct. You know, the breed went into a bad place where they weren't around as much as they used to be. Researching the breed, I knew I wanted a large dog. I knew I wanted a protective dog, guardian type dog. I really limited my choices. I was looking at the Borbo, Cane Corso, but fell in love with the Presa Canario, seeing videos, pictures, and reading up on them. I just felt like that was the breed for me. It just, you know how, just know when you know. I felt like that was the breed for me. The breeders on the island did keep these dogs and did keep the temperament and keep them for protection, keep them to guard the property, guard the family, things.
All right, we should be good. Okay. All right. Sorry about that.
Yeah, sorry about that. I'm sorry, but I muted myself. All right, guys, sorry about that hookup. We got Gavin back on the show. I want to thank Music Game for this. Super Chat, appreciate you, brother. Remember where we left off? I think you were...
Yeah, I was just talking about... I believe I left off talking about just the consistency in litters, and then kind of speaking about how I pick Kaza, and that if you're going for a working breed, you know, and just speaking about all the positives I saw in him.
Right. I think the point we got cut off is we were talking about the white marking, and
okay, yeah. So the white marking, yeah, it was changing. Oh yeah, I remember now. So I was kind of in response to a comment I saw, basically saying the FCI standard is written in stone. That dog has too much white. So the thing about it, I don't agree with that, because it's not written in stone, because it's changed all the time. You know, it used to be 40% white, then it went to 20. I believe that's what it is now. But also, you know, it was registered as Dogo Canarios for years, I believe over 20 years, because it was used, you know, they wanted to take away the word Presa, which means to bite, to catch, seize, hold. You know, they wanted to, you know, a more, what'd you say, a more digestible name, you know, Dogo Canary, you know, basically dog of the Canary Islands, to sell more dogs to the masses. You know, Presa just sounds a little more fierce of a dog, I guess, the name. So that was changed. Then just a couple years ago, they changed it back to Presa Canario, and I could show you paperwork. My first Presa from FCI standard had Dogo Canario on it. Now the ones these days are coming with Presa Canario back added to it. Black was in the UKC standard, but not in the FCI standard. A couple years ago, about a year or two ago, very recently, Black was added. So now you had the same breeders who were fussing at people for breeding Black dogs 5 years ago. Now they have Black dogs because the registry changed it, so now it's all good.
Right.
So then if they change the white to 10%, now you're getting rid of all your dogs that have 20% white.
Right.
I don't see the sense in that.
Right, right. So let me just say something, speaking to my people here at Dogumentary TV. If you're going to be this Dogumentary TV is a channel for canine academics, right? We don't jump on the internet and read a bunch of articles that's based off of one article and think that we know everything about a breed, right? Like me personally, right? I know a lot about dogs. I don't consider myself an expert. That's why when I make these videos for you guys, for the most part, I get people who have lived experience with the dogs, and I interview them, I make the videos, and I bring them to you. And making those videos, I myself get a lot of information that's not found on the internet. And the reality of it is that in this dog world, in this world, period, there's a lot of gray matter in our reality, right? So we talk about things, and we believe things to be true, and it just not 100% right, because people will, especially when you talk about the internet, people are selling you dogs. People are creating a marketplace for dogs, right? And one of the biggest things I wanted to talk about last week, maybe a week ago, I put up a 10 largest dog breeds video. And there's a lot of comments, okay. Oh, the Bos Shepherd is bigger than this and this and that, and these breed, that's breed. A lot of dog breeds that were mentioned to be bigger than the dogs on my list aren't really dog breeds. I mean, they might be in a great scheme of thing that they, you consider them a breed, but if there's no written standard, there's no kennel club standard for the breed, it's not a breed. Right. I consider those to be types of dogs.
Gotcha.
Right?
Yeah.
Because if you have a, if you don't have a standard and you just, and you're just breeding for example, I have pit bull, I have American pit bull terriers and I'm working them and I need them to catch hogs. Right. Mm-hmm. I'm, and I'm not working off a standard. I'm just working off of the, what I need them to do. I might throw in heavier bulldogs because I need my pit bulls to deal with 200-300 pound hogs. Right.
Right. Right.
And it, and then when you look at the phenotype and you look at the dog, it looks like a pit bull. Roughly, if you know, it, but the reality of it is that at 80, 90 pounds, it exists outside the standard of what a pit bull is. So
right.
I go back to the largest dog breeds. We have all these, you know, 190, 200, 210-pound dogs. To me, we have dogs that are supposed to work. I personally don't really see 200-pound dog breeds. First of all, most modest, and let's say humble farmers, people who work with dogs, can't afford to feed a 200-pound dog. If you're in Turkey, if you're in South Africa, if you're in Eastern Europe, if you're in the Middle East and you're really a nomad herd, you know, a shepherd, you can't afford to feed a 200-pound dog. So you're not keeping a 200-pound dog. So to think that you got a 200-pound Bos Shepherd, that dog to me is a modern creation of wealth in the Middle East, right? That's an oil money dog, right? Got and the same thing with the Presa. I remember, I don't remember the comment, and I can't find it right now, but someone was speaking to the weight of your dog at 130 pounds, but you said he's 29 inches. I think they said both of those were out of standard, which, again, I don't, I know a 29-inch dog and 130 pound, that's a great weight. That's still a very much athletic, big dog that can move. Right?
Right.
When you talk about a 29-inch dog that weighs 170 pounds, I got problems with that, you know?
Or even worse, a 25-inch dog that weighs 150. But that's the thing. If you listen to the standard, that would be okay because it's 26 inches at the withers, I believe, for a male, and then they don't have a max weight now. That's something else that was changed. It's just a minimum weight.
Right.
So which one, just like you said, for example, which one do you believe is going to perform more?
Right.
And the thing about it, too, is I just feel like people pick which part of the standard they want to follow. And that's also just something I have a problem with because of Presa. But see, I guess I just look for the things in the standard that translate to the work and the performance. So I've seen Presas. Presas should be longer than they are tall. That's in the standard. They should be rectangular in shape, not box or square shape. Right. But I see that. That shape all the time, but you would see someone who sees a brindle dog with a black mask, oh, that's a Presa. But see my male with all the white and say it's not. But if we're really looking at the majority of the standard, my dog is more Presa than that because 60-40 head, we're not talking about that, you know, longer muzzle to do what? To bite and hold. They should have a longer muzzle. That's why they have a 60-40 head. You know, longer than they are tall, you know, cat footed, things like that, agile, the gait, different things like that. So it's just a bunch of stuff I feel like gets ignored. And we talk about, you know, color, like we're talking about color. And what's so funny is they tell us, like people who may have dogs out of standard color wise and say, oh, y'all breeding for color. No, actually you are, if you think about it, because if you pass up on an exceptional specimen that you produce and then pet home it or call it whatever because of the color, not breed it because of that, who's really breeding for color, you know?
Right. Exactly. And the other point I just got a call with him. It was, I lost track of my thought. Give me 1 second. So I have two sayings, and I'm actually going to probably put these on T-shirts. If you guys haven't seen them, I'll figure out a clever way to put them on. My biggest saying, first and foremost, is a dog is what a dog does. I don't care what breed it is.
I like
if you if you're a real dog person, a real dog man, right?
Yeah.
If you get a dog that does something, that's what that dog is. I don't care if it's, you know, I don't care what breed it is. That just speaks to, I think, the essence and the utility of getting a dog for it. The essence of getting a dog for its utility, its purpose, right? Yeah. So a dog is what a dog does. If you got a Rottweiler and he ain't protective, I don't care what color he is. I don't care who bred him. He ain't a Rottweiler, right?
Exactly.
If you got a Presser that ain't catching nothing, ain't, you know.
Ain't biting, not holding.
He's not a Presser. Right. And then that goes to my other point, back to these extra large dogs, right? I feel like we got a farm dog. You got a 200-pound farm dog. He can't jump into the back of a pickup truck. He's not a farm dog. So if the breed says he's a utility dog on a farm, he works on a farm. If a dog can't run from one side of a 10-acre property to the other side of a 10-acre property, or let's say a 5-acre property, get over there, move, you know, follow a horse, hey guys, give me a second. I got Jason and I got Mohammed calling in. You guys just hold on a little bit. I'm not ready to take calls yet. I'm gonna put you guys in the green room. Just chill there for a second, all right? Jason, Mohammed, just chill out for a second. We're gonna finish this conversation.
And that's funny you said. I remember a quote like that. I can't remember exactly who it was, but I feel like it was a game dog breeder said that, like, basically when a dog doesn't, you know, do what it was bred to do, then you no longer have that breed, you know, paraphrasing.
Right.
But that's, in my opinion, that's very true.
Right.
You know, I've had friends say, you know, which type of presser you like better? And they'll say, whichever one does what it's supposed to do. that's the one I like more.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think that at the end of the day, that's what we kind of have to get to. I mean, I respect the kennel clubs. I respect them as organizations that are doing some preservation work with the dogs. I understand that through the organizations, there's a certain level of popularity and preservation of breeds. The problem is that, you know, sometimes those very same kennel clubs get into being beauty pageants, and we actually lose the working abilities of some of these great breeds. Again, I want people to focus on, you know, we don't want, like me personally, I did a video maybe a year or two ago, and I said, there are no 200-pound dogs. And what I meant by that is that at 200, but there are 200-pound dogs. Like, for example, an English Mastiff, I'll accept a 250-pound English Mastiff, because what is that dog really supposed to do? And I don't really, you know, and that might be, you know, and that might be in a modern context. Like, I'm sure, you know, in, you know, 100 years ago, they were very few.
You look up some of those old English Mastiff pictures, man. They were, you know, they look similar, but I mean, they were way leaner, you know, a lot of leg, long body.
Yeah, exactly. So that's the thing. So, and they're the property guardians. But I mean, you know, like I said, I mean, I don't really think I wouldn't. There are a lot of other breeds that I would get if I had needed a dog. If I needed to do the traditional job of an English Mastiff, there are other breeds that I would get. I would get a Boerbel before I get English Mastiff. I'd get a Presser before I get English Mastiff. I think I'm about to lose you again. I'm not too worried about how much an English Mastiff weighs, because I think the modern context. But when you talk about great breeds like the Presser, the Kangal, the Boerbel, the Dog de Bordeaux, a lot of these dog breeds that people are trying to get into the 170 to 200 pounds size range, and I think they much better at the 130 to 150 dog. I don't even really like a 150 dog. That's just me. I like one. Like, I have a Rottweiler. He's about 27 inches, little under 27 inches the withers. He weighs about 119 pounds.
He's still young.
So, like I said, at the end of the day, when he's 3-4 years old, if he's at 123 to 125 pounds, that's perfect weight. That's what I'm gonna feed him to be that weight, right?
Yeah.
But at his weight, if someone were to come into my house, he can jump a 4-foot wall to get to him. You know, he can jump out a 4-foot window to get to him, right? And those are the kind of things, those are the kind of abilities that any working dog needs. They gotta be able to move. They gotta be able to jump at some point. So I understand, you know, I know I saw that criticism about your dog's weight and height, and I'm just like, people, you know what I'm saying? Like, don't focus so much on the what's the written word, focus on the actual function of the dog and understand right, and that, like you know. Said,
just you gotta, you know, use it. It's all about perception. So yeah, if it's just how you said, if it's 29 inches and 160, 170, yeah, I can see what you're saying. Or if it's 25 inches, 130,
right?
You know, I wouldn't want that either. But to me, like you said, 29 inches, 130, long body,
right?
You know, long legs,
nice bone, you know, all these things come into
the body.
Yeah, all these things come into play, like the head size and the density of the bone. You know, some dogs have better are thicker bone than other dog breeds, and some dogs within a breed are thicker bone, and that will bring extra weight. But at the end of the day, like I said, a dog is what a dog does. If I got a farm dog, if he can't run a good 2 miles at a nice trot, keep up behind a horse, or keep up behind a ATV. Because we don't ride horses no more. ATV, four wheelers. If you can't keep up with the four wheeler, then how are you gonna be a farm dog? If I can't get you to jump into the back of, if I gotta pick you up to put you in a truck, that's not a farm dog. You know what I'm saying? That's like a kid. That's like a baby. Yeah, I gotta pick the baby.
Big kid.
Yeah, big kid. So I'm not with all that. A dog is what a dog does, and I'm gonna stick to that. And I think your dog, as in the videos that you show me, I'm looking at his body type, his leanness, his muscle structure, everything about him says that he works. He looks like he works. Your female, she works. So that's the most important thing. I'm not going to get caught up on the color, again, because he's supposed, and I see the dog in the videos biting. I see the seriousness and attention in which he bites, and he focuses on the decoy in that situation, but the focus is important. So all those things tell me that dog is what that dog does. It's oppressive. And that's why I said, look, we're going to get this guy on here. We're going to talk about it. Because there's a lot of misinformation out there, a lot of people, a lot of keyboard warriors, internet experts. You read 10 articles on the internet, but what you don't realize is that 9 of those articles were written based on the first article. So all information is the same. You're not learning nothing, right? You're just reading the same thing over and over again. And that can be an issue.
What I'm saying, and what I love about me, I own boats. So it's not like I'm speaking from a place where I've always had this type of pressa, and then I'm just speaking from, you know, what I've seen from a distance or on video, on, you know, the internet, YouTube, things like that. No, I've owned, you know, I still own one. You know, who the kennel's named after. That's why we named it after him. His name is Coda. Uh-huh. I keep him as a pet, but you know, I named the kennel after him because he was my first presser, and he's the one that got me into the breed. And without him, I wouldn't have a reason to search for more and look for the type of presser I was looking for.
So, right. All right, so we're going to transition. I think we're about, 38 minutes. We got a couple of folks waiting to talk to you. I'll let you get some questions. This is Muhammad. He's going to step in first. What's going on with you, brother?
How you doing, Zeke?
I'm excellent, man. How
you
doing?
Can you hear me?
Are you great?
I'm all right. How you doing, man? Great show again. Thank you for having me again.
No doubt, man.
So I have a couple questions for the guests.
Move to the other side of the screen. Move to the other side of the screen. So there you go.
All right. That's good?
Yep, perfect.
Yeah, so I got a couple questions if we can get to it. So the first one, I watched a video. You said you in New Orleans, right? Louisiana?
Yes.
All right, I also live in New Orleans, I don't know if you have people come to the, like, to come check your dogs out, but I have a friend that's a big fan of the presses, and, you know, if you kind of have a visitation or any, you know, I'll definitely like to.
Oh, yeah, you're more than welcome to come check them out, or if we have a, you know, we train in New Orleans sometimes, you want to come check out a training session, man, it's all good.
Okay. Yeah, so this is for both of y'all. Like, I've always wanted to ask this question because I never really understand it. So when you get a breed of a dog, right, how do you get a presser? Like, where do you start? Like, do you take a Rottweiler and mix it with a Borbo, then mix it with, like, a different breed? Like, how do you get to the presser?
Let me start this real quick. I want to answer this question. I mean, you're going to answer. Okay. You're going to get the better answer, but I'm going to give you my answer.
Yeah, go ahead.
The first thing you do, you start with the job, right? So you start with like, I got a farm. It's 1700. I got a farm, right? And around me, there's a dog. There might be a wild dog. There might be herding dogs or whatever that's around me. And I look and I basically identify the dog that can do the job that I need done.
Okay.
And then I start breeding that, and I start thinking about that, right? Like, he's doing his job, but, you know, my cows, they don't respect him. He's not big enough. So maybe I find another dog that's a little bit bigger. It's not a breed. It's just a dog, right?
Okay.
So I find, these dogs might be, what's the word? Just in my area, right? Like, this might be around me. So, I'm not going to, this is, you know, 1800s. I'm not going to, or say 1700s. I'm not going to China to get a dog. I'm not going to Iran to get another dog. I'm getting what's around me, and I'm developing. And then in the 1800s, what happens is, throughout history, men start to move. Other people, people from other countries, through commerce, they begin to come in, and they're using dogs, and they have dogs. And I might say, oh, you know, let me get one of those dogs. I put that dog with my dog. And then eventually, in the community, we have a consensus that this type of dog does the kind of work that we need in this community. So we start to breed those dogs. We start, he lives in the farm next door, whatever. We start breeding dogs. We keep these dogs because they do the work that we need them to do. And then at that point, you got a dog, right? Now, what happens with the presses, dogs like the presses, that, and a lot of European dog breeds, is that they had world wars, and a lot of dog breeds, a lot of dog stock was just destroyed in the wars. They had legal changes, which made some dogs, like, for example, dog fighting became less advantageous. And so we didn't need that so much. So those dogs started going away. But in the 80s or the 70s and 80s, with the Conde Corsos, I believe it was the 70s, the Presa, maybe the late 70s, 80s, we got to get these dogs back. So then they begin to identify purebred dogs that kind of did the things and that they could reintroduce to the dogs that they had left to reclaim the breed. And that's kind of how you get it. Now, one of the things that he said in the video was that there's the Bardino Mejero, which is a native dog to the island, which, but let's go ahead, you finish. That's, so that's my thing. That's the world history process of how you create a dog.
Yeah,
it ain't like just, you know, and that's why when people say like, oh, I'm starting a new dog breed today, like, people always email me, I want to do this dog breed. And they want to mix two dog breeds. I'm thinking like, it takes time. It takes history. Process. It takes work. It takes purpose to create a new dog breed. You got to have a reason for it. Just because you like way a Great Dane and a Rottweiler look, you think they look crazy together, that ain't a reason to create a new dog breed.
Exactly.
So go ahead. I'm sorry. Give me your hand. That was my thing.
But nah, that's basically how, I mean, when you think about it, how all breeds come from other breeds, you know? And but with the Presa, the reconstruction of the breed, that's exactly what happened, you know? They find dogs that give them the traits they need to recreate that breed. And the Bardino Mejero, like I said, was a dog native to the Canary Islands. And they even have an island, I believe the island of Ventura is where they actually are really from, because it's several islands on the Canary Islands, you know. So, it just was a dog of purpose. So, you know, they always had Presa type dogs. Different regions of the Canary Islands had them. Even mainland Spain had them. You know, like an Alano. Alano was considered a Presa type dog, you know, because they did the same functions as a Presa, but what? They were a little smaller, a little leaner, you know. So maybe the farmers or the people on that part of Spain needed a dog to run more distance than, say, a Presa on the islands. You know, maybe these were used more for guarding the property. And as long as they, you know, fought off the stray dogs, the wolves, you know, intruders, whether that be animal or human, that was their job. Whereas an Alano was used for more like tracking and running more. So what's going to happen? Those dogs are going to be a little leaner. But if you look at the Alano Espanol, you definitely can see a resemblance. It looks like a leaner Presa, you know? So that's just kind of how you derive at getting a Presa. Now, I don't know if you meant when how you were saying mixing a Rottweiler with this or with that. I mean, at this point we're at, you know, no mixing should be going on, you know, in my opinion. You can find, and that's when it comes into looking for the bloodlines. So that's what I did when I imported my dogs. I'm looking for the bloodlines of the Presa that consistently throw what I'm looking for to incorporate. And, you know, since it's so many different phenotypes in the Presa, but I think that's one thing that does that makes them special, because it's different phenotypes. Because, for example, my program, I might, you know, when I breed Karma and Kaza and I keep hold my puppy back and I see some things I might want to change on the next breeding, you know, I'm going to look for dogs. If I want to add more prey drive, they have bloodlines that, you know, that's why I brought in my puppy Liney from Germany. In Germany, they use the Presas for a little more sport work and more intense type of personal protection training, where these dogs are a little more agile, athletic, and prey driven. So I wanted to combine that with the rusticity of what I had, just that natural aggression, natural drive, and mix that with more of a refined prey sport type dog. And to me, that would be perfect for what I'm looking for. I'm looking for a dog that can turn on naturally and protect when it notices a situation isn't right. And I also want a dog that when we get on the field, they're not going at every person in the crowd or the decoy. They're focused enough to focus on the task at hand on the field, you know, when we're doing protection work. So, you know, that's why I really believe it is more of a type of dog, because the Presa is called a multi-purpose dog. So it has multi-purposes. So depending on the purpose you need it for is the traits you're going to select for. So every kennel or breeding program is going to select for the traits they want to be known for. They want to accent in the Presa, you know?
So I guess my other question is, like, if you want to refresh your, you know, your breeding program and you don't want to just constantly get the same bloodline, you're basically getting other Presas. So there's no one now that's making a new version of Presa starting from scratch. You're pretty much just importing, using different bloodlines.
Yeah, I mean, they do have some kennels, which I don't feel like this is a problem. That's another debate, like I said in the video. It's a lot of gray area with the Presa. You know, they have some breeders that's finding Presas from smaller breeders, older, even more rustic breeders than I found, with more Mahero blood, or maybe even have 25% Mahero, 75% Presa. And to me, that, you know, it's debatable. Some people don't like it. Some people love it. I actually think it's a good thing, because when you look at, if you look at some of the newer dogs and you look at older pictures of the dogs from the islands from the 60s to the early 80s, a lot of those dogs look nothing like those dogs. So how do we get back to that? You know, like, you know, a lot of people say no show standard has ever improved the working breed. I mean, you look at the German Shepherd with the slope back or different things. When you're breeding for function, you're going to keep those old school traits alive, because, like, you know, me and Zeke was on the phone and we talked, you know, there's really not, you know, it's more residential property garden that people would need dogs for. Not too many people on farms like they used to be, you know, in the 70s and 80s. So you know, we're getting away from what the dogs were intended to be. But, you know, people in Texas, I have friends in Florida, they want the true to type Presas because they have a bad, you know, feral hog problem. And, you know, there's open season on hogs, you know, they can go hunting whenever. And a lot of people are using Presas as their catch dogs. So,
yo, you know, Zeke, I got two more questions.
People do need that original.
Let's do one more, man. Give me one more question. Pick your favorite.
All right. Well, I got a controversial one, if you allow it. And ultimately, I don't agree with it, but I just want to.
I can't hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I said it's a controversial one, and I don't really agree with it, but I'm going to throw it in there just for debate purposes.
Uh-huh.
Presa is controversial no matter what.
All right, yeah. So Presa and a lot of these dogs, the Dogo, these dogs are really were really bred for like dog fighting. Obviously, okay. You know, it's been banned, and ultimately, I don't agree on it. But do you feel that we need that type of, you know, not even dog fighting, but something to be able to test these dogs? Because nowadays, these dogs are, like you said, they're not really being preyed upon. You don't have like a Kangal that's really being preyed on wolves. You don't really have dogs nowadays. They prey, you know, they really chasing people. They really just deterring people. Right. Do you think that we need like some type of system to be able to test these dogs? Because
we have it, though.
Yeah, the hog catching, because yeah. That is, you know, like I said, you know, Kaza, Karma, they have dog aggression, but they also just like confrontation. Like Zeke said in the videos, you see how he brings the fight towards whoever's in front of him. So mm-hmm. These dogs like confrontation. So sometimes you have to,
Let me say this. The concept of dog aggression is kind of a misnomer. It's not dog aggression, it's animal aggression, right? Any dog that's dog aggressive is going to be animal aggressive. And like Gavin is saying, I'm definitely against dog fighting. I don't think we need it. And I think that society has moved beyond it, right? So we already deemed it illegal. There's no practical purpose for it. So we don't need to breed dogs that fight other dogs to fight other dogs. But we do have breeds that have a legacy of dog fighting. The Presa, the American Pit Bull Terrier, some bulldogs, some bulldog bloodlines. They're animal aggressive. We do have a reasonable and practical use for those dogs, and that's in the controlling of hogs and other vermin, right? So, for example,
gang dogs use on raccoons and different.
There you go, right? I was gonna say animals. We talk about the American Pit Bull Terrier, we talk about the Presa, we talk about these other big dogs, but dogs like the Jack Russell Terrier, a lot of these terrier breeds are animal aggressive to a certain extent, and they go after small game. Right, so
I've seen them take those terriers to like New York City where they have the bad rat problem.
And they go ratting
I saw that. Buildings,
you know? And they rip through them. So so we don't need to test them in dog fights anymore. But we do need they have an ability.
We can find other avenues.
Yeah, they have the genetic legacy of animal aggression. We have vermin that needs to be removed. We have huge like boar that we can capture, use dogs to catch and dispose of. So that's what we would do with them today. We don't need to dog fight anymore.
Right.
Dog fighting is done.
I agree. I just want to get your opinion on this. I know you're not. So I'm going to say this and then you can, you know, go to the next one. But I wanted to just touch on why you chose a Presa over a Borbo. Because I feel like if I'm going to get the next dog, it's between a Rottweiler and a Borbo. And I know you mentioned in the video you were kind of debating between it.
Let me tell you this. Let me ask you this. What do you need a Presa for?
Well, right now, further down the line, I will want to get a Presa, but I just feel how my life is right now. I'm on my last year.
Right.
Go ahead.
So this is my thing. Gavin has dedicated his life to a certain extent to do something specific for the Presa, with his Presas and his life and his expression through his Presas, right? Okay. If you want a pet, if you want an animal, and I would tell anybody this, you don't need a Presa. You don't need a real one. You don't need a real one.
Yeah.
Right?
No, I think you might have misheard my question. My question was more like, what does he think between a Presa and a Borbo? My favorite dog I would get would be a Rottweiler or a Borbo.
Right. And what I'm telling you, don't worry about what he thinks. I'm telling you, what do you need? Again, a dog is what a dog does.
You see what I'm invested in. I have four Presas,
he didn't choose a Presa as a companion animal. He has a kennel to a certain extent. He has a breeding program. Let's say that not a kennel. He has a breeding program. He has work and he's putting that effort. So if there's a certain amount of work or something that you want to do, then that will inform what kind of dog you get. Right.
Yeah, I see.
Don't start on the other side of it. Start with what do you need? Like I said, a dog is what a dog does.
That he mentioned about the dog fighting. A lot of these dogs, a good Presa, you know, the name Canary, Canary Dog of Prey. A lot of these dogs, they you have a real special Presa and you also have a good trainer, they can manipulate those drives. And when that dog turns the decoy itself into the prey item, you have a problem on your hands. And I've seen some of those. So that's another way to tell. And you know, like I'm saying, just you use the dog, you can manipulate the drives and what you have naturally in the dog with doing the type of training and work we do, you know?
Right. So wrap this up. You don't choose a breed over another breed. You understand, you identify what your purpose is. You ask me, right? Why did I get a Rottweiler and not a Borbal, right? Yeah, I got a Rottweiler because in the breeding stock of Rottweilers, they are far more what I would call considered domesticated. You know, I can choose from a larger breeding stock, right? There are way more reputable Rottweiler breeders and dogs available to me than Borbals in this country, right? You're really going to have to dig and find a good Borbal breeder. And you're going to have to see what they're doing with their dogs. Then you have to apply that to your life. It was easy for me to find a Rottweiler breeder because all I needed was a home guardian. I needed a dog that would be good around my kids and that would bark when people approach my house or that would defend the house. That's what my dog does naturally, right? That's all I needed. Yeah. A Borbal would have gave me other things, and he looked different. But the question would have been, like, first of all, sourcing out a good one because – it's just, you know, there's less breeders, there's less dogs available, so it's a more risky of a choice. Both of you guys are frozen. I hope I'm still going live. Let's see if I'm still live. Nope. Am I frozen too? Yeah, I'm still going. Okay, so you guys are frozen. I don't know what's going on. But yeah, so you don't start with the breed. You start with yourself, what you need. Again, a dog is what a dog does. You figure out what you need a dog to do, and that's the breed you get. All right, guys. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to let you go, Muhammad, and I'm going to see if I can get, let's see. Thanks for the call, Muhammad. Gavin, you're still frozen, and I have Jason calling in. All right, let me get Jason on real quick. Hopefully Gavin will call back in.
Oh, can you hear me, good people?
Yeah, what's going on with you, Jason? Give me 1 second. Let me get Gavin in. Let me,
all right.
There you go. Let me take Gavin. Boom. There we go. All right. We're good. So you froze up on me again, but that's okay. We're ready to go again. Hey, Muhammad, again, thank you for the call. Jason, what's going on with you, my brother?
All right. If you haven't already, do you guys got anything to say about the Diane Whipple events in San Francisco?
Do I have anything to say about it?
Anything you want to say about them, yeah. You have any thoughts on them or whatever?
From what I noticed from the documentary that I watched on it, so I mean, I don't know any firsthand information. All I know is what I watched. The people that own the dog, the two lawyers, I believe they were lawyers, obviously didn't do any of the stuff I mentioned in the video, early socialization, crate training, obedience. I mean, they said, I mean, I remember one part of the video, it's been a while since I watched it, but I remember seeing them talking to the lady and saying how she would check out the door to make sure no one was in the hallway before they brought the dogs outside, and the dogs would basically pull them to be outside. So yeah, a Presa is not the breed for a person who's not gonna train it, who's not gonna set a clear expectation of what's expected out of that dog. You know, it's a problem. Yeah, if Kaza in the wrong hands would probably be in the pound. You know, you have to train, you have to, you know, obedience. What I always tell people is with the Presa, I say this, nothing for free. They don't get anything for free. I mean, and that goes to, affection, as far as me petting them. You know, they have to give me what I want before they get what they want. I have videos on my page of feeding time. They have to do an obedience routine before they even eat. They have to go in the kennel at a down stay. They don't eat until I close the kennel gate and I'm out the kennel, and then I say eat. You know, it just has to be clear expectations. And from what I saw in that video, they had no control over these dogs. I mean, they didn't even know what the dog was. The guy they were defending, bred presses, you know, kind of underground presses. And from what I've heard, his presses, I don't want to say the bloodlines because I don't want to bring any bad light on that. But let's just say the bloodlines that's in those dogs are some serious dogs. And it's bloodlines that people I know still look for, you know, but they look for it, but they're very capable handlers to have them. You know, I would never give a presser to a presser like that to a first time owner who's not dedicated. I mean, you know, in my contract for puppies, obedience, you know, at bare minimum, obedience package, I have to see a training package by a certain time that you have for this puppy, whether it's puppy kindergarten, whether it's a trainer you have. I mean, you know, no training. And from what it seemed like, these people were actually scared of their own dogs. So, I mean, it was just a recipe for disaster, in my opinion.
Zeke, can I summarize the case very quickly?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Okay, so this lady had two presses, is I guess what the media says. I guess they were the presses. And in an apartment building, and they turned on and took on the neighbor, which was a woman named Diane Whipple, and they killed her. And both her and her husband, even though he wasn't even there, I believe, went up on murder charges. Jury returned a guilty verdict on murder. Judge overturned it. Judge overturned a jury verdict, which doesn't happen very often, but it happened in that case. And that's my understanding of it.
Right. So, and I'll say this, as someone that's been around a lot of powerful dog breeds, a lot of dog breeds can kill people, right? Especially two dogs, yeah. Right? Two dogs are 125, 130 pounds. And a woman, I don't remember how big Diane Whipple was.
And they have a pack mentality. So right. Once one goes, the other is going to follow.
Yeah. And it's not going to take much. Now, the reality of it is this, you know, to me, you know, everything about owning a powerful dog breed, whether it's a Presser, a Rottweiler, a German Shepherd, a Belgian Malinois, any dog that's willing to engage in a fight, you've got to, from day one, you've got to understand, as the owner of that dog, you've got to understand that that dog needs limitations, it needs boundaries, it needs to have a certain respect for human life, right? I have a dog that could tear my kids apart, but my dog is very much aware of the repercussions of showing any aggression towards my children or other children, right? So he's aware, and he lives that life, so he's gentle. But in doing that, and understanding that that's what I want from him, I have to do things for him, right? I have to give him obedience. I have to teach him to love to be obedient, right? That's where the food, mm-hmm. with the reward for the food is. I have to exercise him, right? I have to give him. I have to burn off that energy that he has. I have to socialize him. I have to give him, you know, meeting people 101 lessons throughout his early childhood and throughout his adult life, so that he knows. I think one of the things that Gavin said in his definition of socialization is that my dog is not to be friendly with everybody, but he is to understand to be neutral. And to me, I consider neutral to be respectful. And when I say respectful, that means don't crowd people. You're a big dog. He's not afraid of much of anything. He can get into your space, right? He can live in your space and intimidate you. That's what dogs do. I mean, if you ever see two dogs when they go to the park part, they get right up on each other. The taller dog or the more dominant dog, head over shoulders. So that's that right there is disrespectful. So all those things I watch for, and I avoid those, and I don't allow my dogs to do any of that. So it's really about the owner's responsibility to create a structure around the dog and give the dog opportunity, one, to exert his energy, two, to understand how he is to behave in civil society, three, to, you know, recognize situations. For example, gunshots, fireworks, these things can trigger dogs' fear anxiety. So if you don't, let's just say, you know, your dog is a year, for whatever reason, he's never, you're having a barbecue, and all of a sudden, it's 4th of July, you're having a barbecue. fireworks goes off, your dog could go into a crazy panic if he hasn't had the experience to deal with those kind of sounds and understand that. So all those things are important. I don't know the exact, obviously, like, you know, like Gavin said, I wasn't there when the Diane Whipple thing happened. I would, if I was on a jury, I would hold some level of culpability to the owners, because obviously it doesn't seem like anything was done to give those dogs boundaries and opportunities to understand how to behave in civil society. Dogs should not, no dog breed, I don't care, no domestic dog should attack a person.
Yeah.
Right? Unless it's been triggered or informed by its owner. Right? It's just not a good life strategy for dogs. You know, no dog breed was genetically evolved. I know dogs don't evolve, but let's just say no dog breed existed where attacking people was a good idea. So dogs genetically should just understand that it's not right. People feed you. People care for you. Right? They're not wolves. Even wolves don't really necessarily just go around attacking people just for no reason, right? Even a wolf has a natural sense to avoid people in that way, unless it's, you know, there's other issues, you know, unless it's food scarcity, pups are around or something like that, or a person is being, you know, whatever. But anyway, no, I don't know all the details, but I just feel like it's just bad ownership in that situation.
Yeah, but yeah, because one thing about it with, you know, case in point with just something as simple as, you know, a recall, you know, people are asked all the time, oh man, your dogs, listen, how do they, you get your dogs to recall like that and I can't get mine? Like, do you know how many steps you're skipping before you even mention we're talking about a recall? You have to build a relationship and a bond to that dog where he or she knows you're the source of everything. You're the source of play, affection, food. Basically, you're that dog's whole world. You have to build that before you worry about recall. Then the dog wants to come to you. The reason it doesn't come to you, because every ball, every stick, every time the wind blows, another dog passes, that's more important to that dog than you. So that's just on recall. So if we're talking about two dogs getting out of control to the point that they kill somebody, that's showing me, without knowing the whole situation, they had no boundaries, communication, or anything with their owners. You know what I'm saying? So that's how I look at it.
Right. All right. We're going to take one more call. Jason, thanks for the call, man. I'm going to take one more call.
Thank you.
Thank you, brother. I appreciate your call. I'm going to take one more call from Fatima. How's it going, young lady? I can't hear you.
Am I frozen?
No, there you go. We got you. Perfect.
I wanted to ask more about, like, what you were saying about, like, the white up your dog. You were saying that your dog performs better than other pressers, but and your dog is more of a working dog, but mm-hmm. I have like a little bit of different feelings about it, because I feel like when you have a white dog, sometimes can't that like put health reasons in the dogs like other colored dogs won't have? And I also feel like I hear a lot of breeders talk about, oh, the temperament, the working of my dog, blah, blah, blah. But them same breeders sell their dogs to regular people who are not going to work these dogs. And if you keep selling your dogs to regular people who's going to breed with regular dogs, and then they don't understand how you might have a colored dog, but that doesn't mean they're going to get a white dog, because they're not going to the Canary Islands. And they're going to mix their dog to try to keep on getting that white, because they're thinking that that's the color that dog is. That's a natural color of the dog, because they don't understand what a Presa Canario really is.
Mm-hmm. So, okay, with the health concerns of the white coat, Presas actually, and Kaiser, I can speak to that from like not just research, but from hands on. If you know about the Presa Canario and the especially the Russell one, the coat. Okay, the coat. If you look at what does it say in the standard, the coat is a rough coat. The dogs from the island actually have a longer coat. Even a show style Presa Canario coat is longer than, let's say, a Bully, a Pit Bull, a Dogo Argentino that may suffer from, you know, in the hot climates, sunburns and rashes and things like that. Kaza doesn't have any allergies. not one sunburn. He's in a kennel and, you know, outside in New Orleans, it gets hot, it gets humid down here. He's good. Another thing that I didn't mention in the video that I would love to mention, since we're kind of on that subject, is things that breeders overlook. The 60-40 head split is in there for a reason. The muzzle lint, that can keep the dog cool. Looking for wide open nostrils, not pinched nostrils. I mean, this is all things I look for when picking a puppy, because I want stamina for the type of work we do. So a dog that has a short muzzle with pinched nostril is going to gas out quick, probably overheat in New Orleans. And that's not a good thing, you know? So, with the white coat, yeah. And you have to be responsible, but that's why you also have to get a reputable breeder. Like I said, for the last caller, you know, all our puppies come with contracts, and in the contract, it clearly states what's expected of you as the owner, what's expected from me as a breeder. Our dogs are health tested. Our dogs are temperament tested. The puppies are temperament tested before picks. I mean, technically for me, you don't pick your puppy. You tell me what you want in an interview and on a questionnaire. And at about 5-6 weeks, I have a trainer come evaluate the puppies. We write that down on a log, and you're telling me, oh, I want a protection candidate or this or that. I can pinpoint you to what puppy can qualify and be a prospect for that. You're looking for more of a home guardian, then I'm not going to give you the driviest, most dominant puppy that's starting fights with everybody in the litter. I'm not going to place that with a family setting. I'm going to place a confident dog, a confident, good nerve dog with that family, you know? So you have to do research on your breeders. Are some breeders going to shortcut because they may think the white is popular? Yeah, but I can, especially in person, I can tell the difference between someone just adding something to get it white versus a real Presa, because the coat is going to be a dead giveaway. The gait is going to be a dead giveaway. The thick base tail that tapers down, the cat foot paws, you know, all these things that's specific to the Presa. If they don't have it, you know, I'm going to stay away from it.
Yeah, because as a Presa owner, I kind of don't want like people to be misinformed and then start chasing after that type of color of dog, thinking that, oh, that dog is going to have a better prey drive, or that dog is going to be a better working dog, without really understanding this, what you put into these dogs. You can buy a dog, like one of my kids, his mother is just straight. She works on a farm. She works with horses. She works with cows. She works with everything like that. And my female dog is not from a lawn like that. And they do have different traits in them. There is different traits. Everything, a lot of my dog, it comes from me. I walk both of my dogs out here. There's dogs all around. They'll be barking and everything on my dogs. And because when my dogs is puppies, I don't take them to the dog park inside of it, but I take them around the dog park and I make them do everything I tell them to do. I make them listen to me and pay attention to me around a whole bunch of barking dogs who want their attention. It's what you put into your dog. And a lot of times I'm hearing all these people talk about, oh yeah, I have all these working dogs, and they do. There's a lot of beautiful Presa breeders, and there's a lot of people now who's going into the wild, but a lot of people is doing it for the money. And I don't want people to think like, oh yeah, if I get a white Presa, this Presa is going to outperform and they're better than these other Presas. That's not true.
Well, let me say something real quick for Tima. I think if you were to watch the video and just talking to Gavin, I don't think he never identified white as a reason why his dogs were better. He basically just said that white was a natural occurring thing within the rustic Presas. Based on the fact that, you know, the FCI and the UKC have somewhat disqualified the amount of white in his dogs. He never said that, oh, if you get a white dog, it's better. He just said that you have to understand, in the Canary Islands, where people are actually working these dogs, they do have white dogs. And they're not disqualified because of something written in the FCI standard. And that's what he said. And I mean, I think...
Like I said, when I was picking Kaza, and I remember Zeke, and I told you about all the positive traits he showed me, the drive, the guarding instincts, the full mouth bite. If the dog that was more brindle showed me that, then Kaza would be an all brindle dog and not a brindle with white markings dog. I mean, it's just, you got to select for performance if that's what you want out of your dog, if that's your goals for your program.
Right, exactly.
I can respect that.
All right. Well, thanks so much, sis, for calling. I appreciate you. Keep watching, all right? I need more women in my audience. If you ever see a dude get out of line, check that dude. You know what I'm saying? Because you seem to know what you're talking about. And there's a lot of wild ones in my comment section. I need them dudes to get checked, you know. You know, I call them keyboard warriors. They think they read an article on, they read three articles on the internet and think they done owned a dog for 20 years.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thanks again for calling, all right? Have a wonderful day. Yeah. All right, man. We're going to wrap this up. And that was a good call to end on, man. I really appreciate to see, you know, she's a sister and a woman, but she's doing her thing. She got two powerful dogs. She got two presses. I'm going to say that. And she seems to be aware and doing a good job.
Yeah, I like what she said about bringing them around the dog park, but not in. That was great.
That was dope, right? That was a nice, good insight. She thinking. Kylie said,
sure.
You smart.
Yeah, look, smart. Like we talked about being neutral. You don't have to play with these dogs, but you also, I'm not going to bring you in this dog park and set you up for failure.
Exactly. And I do the same thing with my dog. Like, I mean, for example, I never take them to dog parks, but I walk them through the neighborhood. And, you know, we have dogs that fence fight, you know, and he's learned that, dude, you don't engage in that. That's not what you do. That's what they do.
You don't do that.
Like, I don't allow that, you know. So I walked them by. Now, I will admit, you know, he's a little over two. Yeah, if we're close enough to the fence, I don't see the dog. And if the dog hit the fence hard enough, he will react, right? Because sometimes the dogs come, pow, and they just bark.
Yeah, just come out of nowhere and hit
the Yeah, so then at that point, I'm like, you know what? Yeah, go ahead and deal with that. Because if there was no fence there, you know, we would have had to have some
different situation.
Yeah, it'd have been a different situation. All right, I want to thank the Hood Haitian, my man, the Hood Haitian. Oh man, Haitian! I'm just about to make me cry, bro. I got a friend of mine. His name was Andy Gaspar. I haven't really talked about him. He passed away recently. He died in a car accident. But I loved him. He was one of my best friends of all time. I met him in college. He's Haitian. That's why he said that. It kind of just messed with me a little bit. But he's the first Haitian dude I ever met. First dude I ever met to speak I think it's called. I forget what they call it. Creole. I think it's what they call it. I love that brother. I never really said nothing about it because I don't really talk about death so much.
Yeah.
But when I saw the Haitian thing, it hit me different, man. Anyway, shout out to my man, Andy Gaspard. I love you, my brother. We're going to end the show right here, right now. Gavin, thanks a lot for coming on. We're going to do this again, man. You got a lot of information. I'm gonna figure out how we keep doing this. We're going to obviously, hopefully, with Justin's help, you know, he's doing it. Justin's a man. It's your cousin, Justin Williams. I want to send a shout out to him as well for helping us with Justin, this live chat, helping us with the video, and just being, that's your cousin. So
that's my brother-in-law. Justin,
your brother-in-law. Okay, I'm sorry, your brother-in-law. Yeah. And, you know, so that's family. So I'm sure, you know, he does for you what I do for my family, and that's just to be expected.
For sure, man. But, he's always been involved. Like I said, my whole family, man. Helps out at some capacity, man. So
right.
It's awesome to have that support.
Perfect. All right, guys. Well, thanks again for watching. All the Super Chat folks, thank you for supporting the channel. I appreciate that. I'll get Gavin back on here. We'll figure out something else to talk about or bring him on with somebody else, and we'll just keep him pushing, man. Because I think these conversations are good for the community, and we can take this level of our level of thought and engagement with these dog breeds beyond what's being written
and that's
on
the
internet.
Thing, man, what's so funny? I just want to say one thing. What's so funny? Like you said, with some of the keyboard warriors or people who say this is in stone, that's in stone. At the end of the day, like I've said, that it's a big gray area with presses. They have breeders that totally agree with me, even ones that don't. We still can have healthy conversations and debates. I'm friends with some show breeders, some great show breeders. You know, we just have different ideologies of what we think a presser should be, you know, things like that. So it doesn't have to always be beef or a problem. You know, one thing about it, Instagram, they have a comment button, they have a like button, you can choose to like it or not. They have other breeders. If you come on my page, I'm not trying to, you know, push this dog or this type of dog down your throat. If you prefer what you see on somebody else's page, cool. I mean, I'll refer people, you know, people will DM me, tell me what they're looking for. and I might send you to another breed. I said, well, look, I think this might be more suited for what you're looking for. And they respect that. You know what I mean? So it's no problem, man. It's so I don't see why it has to be that big line drawn of this versus that. But I'll be honest with the presses, it's been going on since the beginning of the presses. They always had two schools of thinking. Just the only thing back then, they could at least have events in Madrid and on the Canary Islands where they would meet up at shows or working events, things like that. Now everybody has a phone. All they have to do is type their opinion versus getting out there. So anybody, you know, that's the thing. We trying to get to this training event in Atlanta, you know, September 11th. So that's the thing. If you want to see him in action, we'll be there. You know, I'll post it on my page. You can follow us. We're going to start taking these dogs around the country and working with different trainers and decoys. So, you know, give us a follow. And you want to see the difference or, you know, you're saying they're not like this, they're not that, you come check them out in person.
All right, perfect, perfect. Give me your Instagram again. What is it?
Koda the Presser, Koda the Presser, Theprese.
And that's on Instagram. All right, guys. Thanks again so much for watching. And be on the lookout for some more content coming from the channel. I'm going to be doing some more lives. I'm being real strategic about the live videos that I'm going to be doing moving forward. I want them to be of great value to you guys and hopefully something that you can watch over and over again and get information from. All right, Gavin. Thanks again, man. I appreciate you. You guys out there, I appreciate you guys. See you guys on the next one, all right?
All right, man. Take it easy.
Peace.